Welcome, everyone. Good afternoon, and welcome to the Master Class Series. I'm Shannon O'Neil, and I will be presiding this afternoon. So today's subject is the longstanding alliance between the United States and Japan. And we have no one better to talk about that than our own Sheila Smith. So Sheila has been a senior fellow for Japanese studies or Japan studies here at CFR for many years. Before she joined us, she spent a lot of time in Japan as a visiting scholar and visiting researcher, looking at lots of different issues. She's a very sought after advisor and has been a participant on many formal U.S. Japan commissions. And if you didn't read it last year, she has a great book, one of many books, but her latest book is one that came out just last year, and it's titled Japan Rearmed, The Politics of Military Power. So I am going to turn it over to her in just a minute. I'm going to let her set the stage for the first 10 minutes, give us an overview of U.S.-Japan relations and the alliance, and then we will open it up to a broader discussion with everyone. So please, Sheila, go ahead.
Thank you, Shannon. I'm delighted to be here. It's kind of fun, this idea of a master class. So I'm going to just lay out a few basic ways in which we can understand the very broad and complex U.S.-Japan partnership. And hopefully we'll get into a deeper discussion during the Q&A session. So for many of you, you know this, but our relationship with Japan, of course, goes back to World War II. We signed our first security treaty with Japan alongside the San Francisco Peace Treaty in 1951. That bilateral security pact was revised at the request of the Japanese in the late 1950s and then was ratified in 1960. So this year is the 60th anniversary of the bilateral security treaty. America, the United States, maintains today about 50,000 men and women in uniform in Japan on Japanese bases. It is also home to the only U.S. aircraft carrier that's home ported abroad. And so it is a very important stationing ground for U.S. forces in the region. It not only allows U.S. forces, naval forces in particular, but also our Marine Corps, to operate across the Indo-Pacific, so from what we think of as the East Asia all the way through to the Indian Ocean. But it also is a very important part of the United Nations command support in case of a contingency on the Korean Peninsula. So Japanese bases are not just for U.S.-Japan security cooperation, but are also integral to the UN response in case of a conflict on the Korean Peninsula. So that's the military dimension. Of course, our partnership goes far beyond the military cooperation. In fact, in that renewed security treaty of 1960, Article 2 focuses on our mutual prosperity and the ambition of building economic ties and working together on a host of economic issues. We work closely today with Japan across the region on a variety of issues, as well as in global fora as well. So for example, the United States and Japan work with the countries of ASEAN in maritime capacity building, as we do with Australia as well. We are working with our Japanese partners on developing new digital standards for the protection of new information technologies, but also our defending our privacy rights in our democracies. And that's in the G7 as well as in the G20 forum. And of course, we work very closely with the Japanese, even though they are not a member of the UN Security Council, they have long been a supporting member of the UN effort to ensure nuclear nonproliferation and specifically to support and enhance the efforts of the United Nations to contain and to sanction North Korea for its proliferation of nuclear weapons. So we have a varied partnership. It runs the gamut of almost everything we can think of in terms of American global interests. And we are usually aligned in values with our Japanese partners. We don't always agree on everything. And that's important to understand. Our allies don't agree with us 100% of the time, but we have a very strong working partnership. It's not just about our bilateral relationship, but also about the region and the globe. And then finally, I think it's really important now as we watch in Japan the transition from Prime Minister Abe to Prime Minister Suga. I get a lot of questions these days about, well, what is that going to mean for Japan-US cooperation in the region? Is that going to change? And I think that it's very clear that since Prime Minister Suga made his first visit abroad to Vietnam and Indonesia, and the theme of that conversation with his partners in Vietnam and Indonesia was, of course, the free and open Indo-Pacific. So the United States and Japan have a lot of common interests in making sure that we sustain a rules-based order in and across the Indo-Pacific. And Japan now works very closely alongside us with Australia and India, not only in the economic realm and the diplomatic realm, but also increasingly in the military realm, which is a new piece of Japan's sort of instruments, if you will, that it brings to its statecraft in the region, and it's welcomed across the region. And I think, you know, what we think in the U.S.-Japan partnership of the United States leads and Japan comes along, that old model of thinking about our relationship, particularly in the region, has really given way to a much more well-articulated Japanese vision for the Indo-Pacific. Again, we emphasize at times different pieces of that vision, but there's no doubt in my mind that Japan today is an active player in making sure that the region has a sustainable economy, has open sea lanes, and has a strong partnership, not only with those bigger powers, India and Australia and us, but also with the Pacific Island states and with the many countries of ASEAN that Japan has longstanding deep ties with. So we have a partner in Japan that's very different than the 1950s and 60s. And we have a partner in Japan that's looking forward to expanding our ability to work, again, not only bilaterally, but in the region and beyond globally as well. So that's a very quick version, but there's my intro.
Great. Well, I will kick it off with the first question, but Tegan, could you just tell us again how people can get in line to ask a question themselves?
Absolutely. Ladies and gentlemen, as a reminder, to ask a question, please click on the raise hand icon on your Zoom window. When you are called on, please accept the unmute now button and proceed with your name, affiliation, and question. Another reminder, to view the roster of CFR members registered, please click on the link in your Zoom chat box. Shannon?
All right, there. Let me take you to this last point that that you just sort of ended on, and this idea that it's no longer Japan following the United States, but Japan has this bigger role. And maybe talk a little bit about the evolution, if you would, of both Japanese capacity to project and the kinds of things that they do, whether is it mostly hard security, is it economic, or how do they balance? What are the kind of various tools that they use in the region? And how has that evolved over time, either on its own or in conjunction with the United States? A little bit of how do they do this and how has that role changed over the last several years?
Okay, sure. So we're looking at a 60-year swath of time. So I'll do big broad brushstrokes. But of course, as we're coming out of World War II, Japan had to recover, much as the European countries had to recover. And so you're not until the 1960s seeing Japan with an economy that has some stability and is growing in a way that the Japanese people can feel and experience in terms of their own wages, right? Japan had to negotiate peace treaties outside of that San Francisco framework, and you saw throughout the 1960s, overtures to its neighbors in Southeast Asia, to South Korea in the mid-60s, and again, much later with China in the 1970s. The economic ties were a big part of its relationship with the region. And the United States supported that, but of course, that was a negotiation between Japan and its neighbors to try to overcome, obviously, some of the ill feelings and the legacies that were still part of the Asian response to Japan after World War II. By the time you get to the 1980s, though, we all know this, right? The Japan had emerged as a dynamo, right? It was the economic superpower. That was the new language. It was a trading nation. It had succeeded without hard power. And there was a lot of IR theorists who thought that was an interesting model. In other words, not all about hard power in terms of how you achieve your interests across the globe. And so Japan was kind of a different model in lots of ways of a major power. And it sustained its position as the second largest economy in the world until 2011, where China overtook it in absolute the size of its economy. But Japan is still the third largest economy. The relationship with us, of course, we can, you know, jump forward to the 1980s and our trade disputes and our, you know, fights and the Congress smashing Toshibas on the steps of all that drama and some very tough trade negotiations to open the Japanese market, to get the Japanese to liberalize, especially in sectors like agriculture, where they were very, very resistant. Our former co-chair, Carla Hills, was a very effective agent at prying open the Japanese market. But you have today a Japanese U.S.-Japan relationship in particular that's really quite astounding given all that differences, the differences we had in the past. So today, Japan is our third largest, it's the third largest economy in the world, but it's the fourth largest trading partner for the United States. It's the fourth largest investment partner for the United States. It is the largest holder of U.S. government debt. And I think a lot of people erroneously think that we should be worried about China. Well, in fact, we should say thank you to Japan, because the Japanese consider to invest in us in ways unprecedented, and sustaining investment in us in ways that are unprecedented. Our exports to Japan are probably about $120 billion last year. Bulk of that, $75 billion, is in goods, $45 billion in services. So you see the composition of our trade is beginning to shift in the direction of services as well. We are still the largest trading partner for Japan. So we get, for Japan, about 20% of their trade is with us. And North America is also home to a number of Japanese major multinational manufacturers in particular. So we are a market that the Japanese corporate world finds secure and finds worth investing in. So we have a very close economic partnership. Both our economy and Japan's economy rely on this partnership for their growth and stability. I think what's been interesting, though, is to watch how we now are trying to cooperate abroad together. And a little footnote on the trade side, I am, of course, or was a supporter of the TPP, now the CPTPP, which I know you are very familiar with, and, you know, would have been very happy to see us join in that effort. And I think what was interesting about the negotiations over the Trans-Pacific Partnership was it wasn't just the United States and Japan at loggerheads. And I think if you talk to lots of our trade negotiators here in town in DC, they were, oh gosh, Japan, it's going to be hard. But in fact, Abe and President Obama really said, all right, this is where we need to create rules. We need to move forward. We need to move the agenda of trade liberalization forward, not only for its economic benefits to each, but also for the strategic benefits it would have. So until we exited at the beginning of the Trump administration, we also saw Japan as a really constructive partner in moving trade liberalization forward across the across the Pacific.
What do you think the chances are that we might re-enter or we might be re-engaged with the CPTPP? What are your thoughts on that?
So I'm not an American politics specialist. I will leave that to you and others, but I would like to see us do it. I'm not sure how the trade agenda stacks up at the moment in terms of both our house, right? We have to not only look to the White House, but we have to look to the Congress.
How does Japan look at it? Are the other members... Welcome, please come back.
You know, when we had all those the visuals of, you know, President Trump and Prime Minister Abe in that first visit in 2017, when he came and he went to Mar-a-Lago and they went to play golf, Abe spent many of his summits with President Trump, really trying to tell him why TPP was not only in Japan's interest or the region's interest, but also in America's, and what it meant to set the standards, trade standards at a higher level, what it would mean also for geostrategic competition with China. So he didn't manage to persuade President Trump on that, as you know, but I do think there's a great appetite for us to come back, but we won't be there, right, setting the rules, setting the stage. And so that will be a wrinkle, so to speak, in our ability to negotiate with not only Japan, but Australia, New Zealand, other countries around that deal, right?
Let's take the first member question, please.
We will take our first question from Fred Hochberg.
Hi, Shannon. So we've read a lot about, Sheila, in the last month or so, the Quad meeting in Japan, the addition of India, Juan, just how important is that? Or was that a little bit of a photo op before our election? And, you know, the dispute related to that, the whole dispute with China and Japan over the islands in the East China Sea, do we take that seriously enough or do we not as Americans?
Excellent questions, and I really love your tomato. I am a gardener, so that's really nice. I love it. Two pieces. The Quad, does Japan take the Quad seriously? Absolutely. But, you know, what I see is the Quad is it's a little bit in the eye of the beholder among those four countries. So the United States' view of the Quad and the utility of the Quad is largely a more hard power formula for trying to think about how to intensify and deepen military cooperation. Doesn't mean we don't have an economic ambition. We don't have economic or ambitions as well, but our hard power objectives are pretty clear. Japan sees this as both hard power and soft power, if you will, or economic power. In a way, it takes this very focused approach that it is time to not only sustain the current open and free Indo-Pacific, but to build new networks, new communications with others, with like-minded countries, so that it remains a free and open Indo-Pacific. So it's partly Japan's strategy for competing, right, with China for how to define the future of the regional order. India is definitely on board, and my colleague Elisa Ayres can certainly talk to you about that, but they are definitely on board in some of the economic initiatives that would come from the Quad. Japan is deeply engaged in helping India, not only with infrastructure, but also on the digital side. And then Australia, of course, has both hard power and more economic power interests in making sure that the four powers who are democratic also bring those values to bear in thinking about the kind of order that is created in the region. So I think depending on whatever moment you're talking about the Quad, just be alert to the fact that there's a slight different emphasis from each of those four countries. My own sense of it is it's a very productive avenue for thinking about where we can and cannot cooperate. And I think India in particular is more concerned about the hard power side of it. They would not like to be perceived as, you know, this is a formal alliance building or a containment of China strategy. Nonetheless, I think India has more of an appetite for the Quad than it did, you know, several years ago, given its relationship with China at the moment. But I think the Australians have also gotten much, much more interested in the Quad. And they had very split public opinion about whether or not that would create a world in the Indo-Pacific that was antithetical, that would raise hostilities rather than create a more stable environment. So evolution is not only between the countries, but also in the terms, in the way the countries are interacting with China these days. I think the challenge on the Japan-China side is Japan would still like to see an open, right, and free, transparent, rule-based order. So they're still engaged in a conversation with Beijing that would like to have Beijing embrace this idea of maybe not the Quad, obviously, but the free and open Indo-Pacific. And they are trying to temper that with beefing up their defenses, making sure the Senkaku Islands, Diaoyu for the Chinese, are not vulnerable. The Chinese military, the PLA, both its air and naval forces are increasingly active in and around Japanese maritime and airspace, not just those islands themselves, but through the straits that go through Okinawa, the southernmost islands of Japan. They're increasingly present in the Bashi Straits, which is the straits in and around Taiwan. So if you can close your eyes and imagine a map of southern Japan, when you're talking about the East China Sea and into the South China Sea, those are all one and the same increasingly for thinking about how the Chinese military is increasing qualitatively as well as quantitatively its ability to affect maritime traffic and control airspace in that area. So Japan is very worried about that. Australia, India, more distant from that. But Japan is trying to thread the needle, so to speak, with China on inviting China to play a bigger role. Responsible stakeholder is not a word the Japanese use with China, but I think they would like to see a better, more constructive role with China in the region, but they're very conscious of the territorial issue. On the United States policy, President Obama was the first president to say that the Senkaku Island, that Article 5 protections of the U.S.-Japan bilateral security treaty do apply to the Senkaku Islands. He said it out loud and at the highest level of our government. President Trump said it too in February 2017 when Abe came to visit. So I expect a future President Biden will also make the same affirmation that the United States sees the Senkaku Islands as territory administered by Japan. And should there be a threat to that territory, the United States will see it as invoking Article 5 protections.
Great. Let's take the next question.
We will take our next question from Ellen Frost.
Ellen Frost, East-West Center. Great comments, Sheila. I would add to your list the Partnership for Quality Infrastructure, emphasis on quality, and in general economic statecraft in the region, which is implicitly a challenge to China, but it's a positive sort of win-win. They've also helped us with defining standards for this kind of investment. The weak spot, I would say, was the Japanese companies aren't necessarily enthusiastic about these investments. My question, though, is different and very short. The current tensions with Korea and Japan, how and in what ways do they affect the functioning of the U.S.-Japan alliance, and do you see any kind of breakthrough in the future?
Thank you, Ellen. Thank you also for bringing up the infrastructure piece, which I think is increasingly important for the U.S. and Japan and the region. So the Japan-ROK relationship, this could be a whole masterclass by itself, so I'll try to be as brief but as succinct as I can, let me put it that way. We are at a very difficult time in the Japan-ROK relationship, and last year was worse than this year. Things seem to have quietened down, but we do have several factors here that continue to affect the possibility of Japan-ROK getting their relationship on a better and more constructive ground. As you all know, and there's a lot of Asia expertise on this call, so forgive me for the abbreviated comments I'm gonna give you. The Japanese government believes that issues of compensation for forced labor, for POW treatment, for many of the egregious behaviors that occurred under Japanese colonization of South Korea, that those were resolved in the 1965 Basic Agreement, which was a treaty, a normalization of relations. This is a different ball of wax legally, in a sense, because it was not only about the war and wartime damages, it was also about the colonial experience of the South Koreans. That 1965 Korea, as many of you are aware, is a very different South Korea than we have today. Today, Korea is a democracy, not an authoritarian state. And so the terms of that peace treaty are respected by the Korean government, but there are some aspects of it. One having to do with the so-called comfort women, or the women who were forced to work in Japanese military brothels during the war. And now this question of forced labor, laborers who were asked to work in Japanese companies, not asked, they were forced to labor in Japanese companies. These are court cases that had been tried in Japanese court and then are now present in South Korean court. And the Supreme Court of Korea has identified several Japanese companies that owe indemnities to these laborers. Legal experts will give you a much more sophisticated answer. I'm going to leave it at that for now. The assets of several companies have been expropriated in keeping with the South Korean verdict. Japanese government does not accept this and says that the two governments negotiated in 1965 and the Japanese government paid money specifically for these kinds of issues. But clearly in the public's eyes in South Korea, the diplomatic conclusion in 65 was insufficient. I think there's a lot of very deep sentiment in both countries of antagonism over the continued war legacy, the sort of incompleteness of the war legacy resolutions. And they're multiple, they're not just one. I think it's also difficult at the moment because Prime Minister Abe tried, President Moon tried to do the right thing, but I think domestic politics in both countries made it very hard for the two of them. They come from very different political backgrounds and political ambitions. I think the third thing I'd say, Ellen, and this is the part where I have increasingly wondered aloud on the CFR blog in one place is, I think the long-term strategic outlook in Seoul and Tokyo, the way that they look at the future of the region, in fact, the way they look at China, is very different, as well as the options they think they have. And I think that's a challenge for the United States, for US policymakers, because I think increasingly they just don't see the same world, or the same region, I should say. And our trilateral cooperation, US, Japan, South Korea, was very focused on the North. North Korea and the North Korean threat. Japan is very vulnerable, of course, to North Korean missiles and potentially from the decoupling that might come from a nuclear North Korea. South Korea is worried about these factors, but feels less of the vulnerability, I think, that Japan's vulnerability is new. The South Koreans have lived with the threat from the North for a long time and see different avenues, negotiation, a peace treaty perhaps, right? So I think you were starting to see a region where their sense of threat and challenge is becoming less overlapping than it had for much of the Cold War. And I think that's also a factor to realize.
Great. Let's take another question.
We will take the next question from Jonathan Masters.
Hi, Sheila. Hi, Shannon. Good to see you both. It's been a while. I have a question actually on energy security, because believe it or not, I think that next March is the 10th anniversary of the Fukushima disaster. And Sheila, if you could maybe just talk about what the legacy is of that, you know, and how kind of, you know, energy security will factor into Japan's foreign policy. And particularly, I think that, you know, the Prime Minister just announced that Japan's going to be carbon neutral by mid-century and sort of how all that comports together. Thank you.
Thank you, Jonathan. I would say nice to see you, but I can't see you. So nice to hear you. I am not a specialist on Japanese energy policy, so I'll just put that out there because I'm there are others in this group actually who are more informed on the more recent decision by the Suga cabinet than I am. But the long-term trajectory here is, of course, that Japan for decades now has seen self-sufficiency in energy as being available through increased investment in nuclear energy. And of course, the Great East Japan earthquake and the tsunami that affected the Fukushima Daiichi reactor changed that. The DPJ, the Democratic Party of Japan, was in power in 2011. They had in their energy policy moving Japan up to 40% of nuclear power by mid-century. And that was a pretty ambitious renewal project for nuclear power in Japan. That, of course, cannot happen. Japan, at the time of the Great East Japan earthquake, had 54 operating reactors, some of which were quite elderly. Fukushima probably being one of them. And they all were turned off. I don't have the actual number today of how many have been able to go back into operation, but local governments around Japan have been very hesitant to buy into the government's new security regulations that were created in the wake of that disastrous accident. So you find lots of local politics, localities that house these nuclear reactors, of course, depend on them for government revenue, right, from the center. But the citizens who are in the next municipality and sometimes the prefecture, they don't feel as comfortable, right, as the municipalities may. But I think it's a question of nuclear safety. It's a question of how the regulatory framework that was built, the government regulatory framework after 2011 was rebuilt. I still think there's a lot of skepticism about that, the ability to have safe nuclear power in Japan. All that being said though, Japan, as you know, imports up to 90-something percent of its fossil fuels, right? Its LNG comes from Russia and other places. We are now exporters, or about to be exporters to Japan, of natural gas. So Japan is trying to diversify its sources of energy, but that still raises up the current account surplus there. It's not a good balance, trade balance for Japan, those numbers over the long haul. And also it ameliorates or it mitigates the opportunity for self-sufficiency. So I see in Suga's decision-making, not a walk away from nuclear power, but a reckoning that Japan is gonna have to move to a carbon neutral footing if it is going to not have to bear the costs of being so dependent on external sources of energy. So I'm kind of curious to see how this is going to unfold. And I'm not sure if I answered the question fully, but I think you're seeing Japan, especially the conservatives, the LDP, come to the realization that they have to invest differently going forward and to be much more out front in terms of transforming the sources of Japanese energy supply.
The next question, please.
Certainly. Just before I announce the next question, ladies and gentlemen, as a reminder, to ask a question, please click the raise hand icon in your Zoom window. When you are called on, please accept the unmute now button and proceed with your name, affiliation, and question. We will take our next question from Jonathan Wheeler.
Hi, Sheila, how are you?
Hi, John. Good, how are you?
Good. I'd be interested in your take. If there's any changes you expect in the relationship, if any, with the new Biden administration in January. Prime Minister Abe, of course, was one of the best in the world at handling President Trump, if that's the right word. And luckily for Mr. Suga, he won't have too long to try to duplicate that act. But, you know, more generally, there are many in Europe and elsewhere that feel that even post-Trump, the reliability, the trustability, the predictability of the United States has been compromised for the long term, and that they may have to go it more alone. And I just wonder how you see Japanese attitudes on that, both official and among the people.
Thank you, John. That's a great question. So let me start off with what I think was going on during the Abe cabinet, because I think it was interesting to watch. So we all, as you just did, admired Abe's ability to manage our unpredictable president, right? That doesn't mean that Japan got everything it wanted. Obviously, it didn't get TPP, which is where we started. It also couldn't protect itself from the tariffs on steel and aluminum, right? It couldn't negotiate away from, it didn't get protection on some of the core interests that Japan had. Nonetheless, it did invest heavily on military weapons systems from the United States. They have rolled back some of that, honestly, because it's too expensive. So the management of Prime Minister Abe's ability to have a personal relationship with President Trump and what that allowed the U.S.-Japan alliance to avoid, right, was the kind of threatening language over Article 5 protections that you saw early on in NATO, right, or the kind of really draconian demand for renegotiating trade and renegotiating host nation support or burden-sharing costs that you saw with South Korea. Some of that was serendipity. Japan's burden sharing agreement doesn't come up for renegotiation until next year. So Japan managed to sidestep that a little bit. But what I thought was also interesting, John, was not just what Abe managed with the United States in this difficult time or unpredictable time with the United States, but what he managed to negotiate around President Trump and the CPTPP. It would be one prime example. The other is the Japan-EU trade agreement. Okay, at a point when the United States is pulling back from multilateralism and trade, Japan went full throttle. And I think that was an interesting accomplishment. It was an interesting focal point for me to watch how Abe was trying to deal with the more unpredictable United States. I think it'll take some time for us to know what Japanese calculations are about the reliability or the credibility of the United States going forward. I would hate to hazard a guess. I'm sure lots of Americans are also thinking about that question, because our politics are, just because we are, the election is behind us, clearly our politics are more contentious. I think Americans are asking fundamental questions about our engagement, especially about the perception that we are footing the bill for our allies. Perception, I think, is wrong, by the way. But I do think it is going to be something the Japanese will watch carefully to try to read the new administration and how they're going to approach. Two areas I expect will be in the headlines, at least in Tokyo, if not in Washington. One is the Biden administration's approach to China. And as you know, that the pressure of China on its neighbors is growing and growing. Japan is no exception, despite what I noted earlier. And they're looking for a pretty tough American approach. They don't want what they see as engagement. They don't want to step back from the tough line that they thought that the Trump administration was putting forward. I can't read the Biden administration's China policy, but if you look at the people who are engaged in the Biden administration and foreign policy advisors, I don't think you're going to see people stepping back. I think you're going to see people who are going to want to engage China in certain ways where we can, on issues where without the two of us working together, the world or the region will be in trouble. And I hope, personally, I hope we see that. But I think there will be a really cautious look at where the Biden administration is going to put its emphasis on the China piece, right? The second is, you know, the Biden administration has advocated allies first and appreciation of the need to build coalitions. I think that coalition building approach is very much welcomed in Tokyo. for all the reasons I outlined earlier when I was talking about the Indo-Pacific. I think a coalition approach to many of the problems, be it about Chinese cyber activity, be it about sea lanes and open, you know, maritime activity, be it about technology transfer and technology theft, all kinds of issues where we see foreign intervention in democracies, all kinds of difficult issues. I think the coalition approach will be very welcome in Tokyo. I think they'll wonder whether the United States can sustain that over time. And so there will be some question about it, but I think the approach will be welcome. And the last piece, John, is the host nation support. We are due to negotiate burden sharing costs with Japan. And so they'll be looking to see whether a Biden administration continues along the line that President Trump outlined, or whether they're going to come at this in a more strategic way. In other words, it's not just going to be about dollars and cents, but about the ways in which the U.S. and Japan, the two militaries and the two sets of diplomats, will be able to carve a strategic future for the region that will be reassuring for both.
Sheila, let me just ask you to expand a little bit on Japan's relationship with China and sort of one, how they see this hard approach from the Trump administration. I share your sort of sense that a Biden administration is not going to fully back down because there does seem to be a bipartisan consensus in Washington of having a bit of a heavier hand vis-a-vis China. But one, I'd be interested in one is, what are the aspects of this stronger policy towards China does Japan like, or which parts don't they like? I mean, is decoupling, is the technology part that they like? What are the things that they like? And then also, I'd like you, I heard you when you were talking about the Japanese-Korean relationship saying that they diverged in their views on China. I'd love for you to just expand that a little bit more. Where does Japan sit vis-a-vis China? And is there a lot of light between its view and a lot of its neighbors, whether Korea or say some of the ASEAN neighbors? Kind of, is there a consensus there, or is Japan an outlier in some way, the way they see China?
Well, I think, yeah, I wrote a book about this not that long ago. Thank you.
Give us the highlights.
Thank you. In 2015, I wrote a book called Intimate Rivals, where I looked at the domestic politics of China's increased influence and how that affected domestic politics in Japan. So not just rise of China and the government reaction, but how it was really influencing Japanese people at different parts of their national debate. The thing I find it's interesting is around the region, what I was hearing from others, so be it in ASEAN or even in Seoul, is that if China can do that to the Japanese, they'll do it to anybody in the region. Because Japan is an advanced industrialized economy. Japan is not necessarily easy to push around. It may not value its hard power position the way we might, right? But I think it was an eye-opener. And I heard this from my friends in the Philippines. I heard it throughout ASEAN. I heard it from my South Korean colleagues quietly. That China flexing its muscle, and this was specifically to the rare earths issue, but also just to the confrontation itself over the islands, that China was ready to be a much more assertive player in the region, and that even Japan wasn't going to be immune from this. So I think you don't necessarily see Japan as outlier on China. I think what Japan can bring to the table is probably the kind of leadership on the Indo-Pacific strategy or vision, the kind of diplomatic activism, the coalition building, if you will, that smaller countries actually cannot, that Australia would be hard placed to do this all by itself. Japan, Australia, right, can do it together. Japan, Australia, India, even better, and then put us in the mix. And of course, that's a great effort. But I think Japan has more range or in the diplomatic arena in the region that it can bring to bear, even more, I would say, than the Republic of Korea, which has been not opposed to the Indo-Pacific vision, but South Korean security is very focused on the peninsula. And while there has been some little bits of maritime cooperation here and there, they're not necessarily ready to jump on board on the Indo-Pacific, especially if they perceive Japan as leading the game. So there is a little bit of tension on that as well. But I think on the decoupling piece, the supply chain piece that you're writing your new book about, Japan has had different phases of diversification. And in the late 1990s, Japan began to diversify some of its supply chain activity from China, largely because of wages going up in China. So largely because of economic decision-making in China, not because of the strategic piece. You are now looking at, in the wake of the pandemic, of course, the Japanese government is offering financial support to companies that want to relocate out of China. Those companies tend to be small and medium-sized companies, though. Those are not the Toyotas. They are not the big long-term investors in the Chinese economy. Those are largely consumer manufacturers, right? Consumer goods manufacturers, and they want to have access to the Chinese consumer. That's why they're there. But for smaller, there's some smaller Japanese companies that really find the difficulty of doing business and the uncertainty is problematic, and the Abe cabinet put forward some money in their pandemic response for those to help with relocation. So diversification and supply chain will come from a lot of different places. You gave a talk at CFR the other day, and we talked about Thailand, right? Mm-hmm. The disasters and floods of Thailand. So the Japanese have had to adjust, right, as they go, depending on what the cause of the instability is. I think the one piece on the Japan-ROK relationship, just to close out your three big questions, is the tension that we typically see between Japan and ROK has largely been about war legacy, right? It was about strategic cooperation and information sharing, something the United States government really wanted across the three allies, right, in the region. Seoul was less enthusiastic, but in the end did it. But what was new last year was the export control issue. And of course, the Japanese basically announced this, unbeknownst to many of us here in the United States, that they were going to get South Korea off of their white list, their preferred trading partner list, because they weren't quite sure that Korean companies were taking enough steps to make sure that these technologies weren't ending up in the North. Mm-hmm. Big blow, as you know, to Samsung and other companies that were really deeply integrated with some niche technologies in Japan for the production of some semiconductors and chips, right? That was a mind-blowing kind of decision by the Japanese, largely because it came out of the blue. Everybody was surprised. It seemed counterintuitive given Japanese exposure in supply chains, but it was one of those pieces of the puzzle where you wonder was that a strategic decision? Was it just a demonstration that Japan could make it certain parts of the Korean economy hurt if it wanted to? Still to this day, I can't tell you. Was it a mistake? I don't know. But you see that the Japan-South Korea relationship now has the difficulties have bled over into the economic realm in a way that's not terribly healthy, not only for the bilateral relationship, but also for the broader regional economic supply chain, that whole network of economic ties across the region.
Yeah. Thanks, Sheila. Let's take the next question.
We will take our next question from Leticia Guerrero-DeCayu.
Hi, Sheila. Hi, Shannon. So I have a two-pronged question. First, I was hoping to come back to the China issue. One of the things we know we will likely see under a Biden administration is the U.S. working with democratic allies in the region to offer an alternative to China's digital Belt and Road expansion mm-hmm. that is anchored around shared democratic values. So I was hoping you could comment to the role you see Japan playing in this and whether some assets like the Asia Development Bank could be better leveraged. And then the second part of my question on a completely different topic, you highlighted some areas for U.S.-Japan cooperation, in particular cooperating abroad, but I was hoping you could also discuss potential tensions in the relationship in the coming 4 years.
Excellent. I'm gonna try and be quick because I know we don't have much time and my answers get to be long-winded. So let me just try to touch very briefly on those two important questions. So, there's lots of ways in which I think the U.S. and Japan have an opportunity here in the digital sort of norm setting, rule setting area. And if you look at their bilateral trade agreement that was concluded, that was one of the pieces that the U.S. and Japan negotiated. So I think we've got lots of room. There are some who argue, friends of mine who are more in the political economy realm of the relationship, argue that bilateral agreement could be the basis for, if not regional, at least for gathering in the G7 around a core set of digital rules for digital expansion. So I think Japan's a player. I think Japan wants to be a player. You saw Mr. Abe at the G20 meeting put forward his vision of how he would like to move that forward. I think particularly in line with in the wake of COVID, you're seeing this balancing act between medical, biomedical information sharing and privacy rights, something the Japanese want to work very closely with us and others in the G7, G20 with. So I think, yes, Japan will be there. Whether it's the trendsetter, whether it's the country that leads completely on that, I'm not so sure, but I think it definitely wants to be at the table. So that's a very quick and cursory answer to the first question. And yes, the ADB can play a significant role here. And I think even more, the Japanese investment bank, JBIC, has already started down that pathway as well. So it can be bilateral as well as regionally funded and move forward. On the where are the tensions, I'll come back to China. I could also come back to North Korea, and I could come back to Taiwan. And I'm not saying that because I think all those are going to blow up. So I'm being very quick here. But the dissonance, if a considerable amount of dissonance erupts between Washington and Tokyo on the China piece, I think that will be a significant strain on the relationship. Islands, Shannon, I'm not so worried about, because our military and our security, national security folks are very conscious of the East China Sea and what it means. And that whole first island chain, so that, you know, Japan all the way through the Philippines, very important for our military. And so I see there's really strong advocacy in our government for close cooperation with Japan there. So I'm not so worried about the islands in that part. But I am worried about where to compromise and where not. How much allies are consulted on compromises that a Biden administration may or may not see it needs to make. The allies first coalition approach of the Biden administration, I think, is the ticket, frankly. Executing that will be difficult because coalitions are difficult to manage, right? And you are dealing with a considerable power in the region. Getting everybody aligned and on board is a heavy lift. And I'm not saying it can't be done. I'm just recognizing the challenge ahead. So I think China is our biggest place of strategic dialogue between Tokyo and Washington, because we want to get it right. On the Taiwan piece, of course, Japan doesn't have the same policy on Taiwan as we do. And Japan has been very hesitant to embrace a formal role in the defense of Taiwan's democracy or in the defense of Taiwan against mainland China, right? Because it doesn't have a Taiwan Relations Act, it doesn't have a military role in a Taiwan Straits contingency. And yet Taiwan sits right there, very close to Japan's southwestern islands. But the politics of decision-making on Taiwan could be slow, and that may frustrate people here in Washington, should we need to make some kinds of decisions about how to react. And then the last is North Korea. You know, this is the missile arsenal of the North Koreans now can reach out and touch Japan. It doesn't have to be an ICBM to get to Japan. Japan doesn't have a ballistic missile capability of its own, so it relies still on ballistic missile defenses, which the Korean arsenal now can really overwhelm if we really think about ourselves in a conflict. So I still think there's homework. And again, that's back to where the Japan ROK piece is so, so critical. And we are all a little bit worried here that the transition to a new administration is always an opportunity for the North Koreans to test our resolve and to test the two alliances in Northeast Asia. So a little slippage there could really make Japan nervous about whether or not its defenses are well considered here in Washington.
Well, Sheila, let me extend my thanks and thanks of everyone here for a sweeping take on Japan and the US and its role in the world. We appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Shannon. It's been a pleasure.
That's great. Well, all of you, please join us again. We'll be back in 2 weeks with Adam Siegel on November 24th to talk about cybersecurity issues. So until then, stay well and stay safe. Nice to see everyone.